Upfront Books presents Shame Interrupted: How God Lifts the Pain of Worthlessness and Rejection. Written by Edward T. Welch and narrated by Robert Christesen. Preface. At the end of most chapters, you will hear a list of questions and comments based on the themes of the respective chapter. These are meant to prompt reflection or help to facilitate a discussion as you listen to the book. Dedication to David Paulison, kindred spirit and friend. Working side by side is an honor. Chapter 1: The Quiet Killer. Shame greatly hurts or greatly helps mankind. Homer. I hate shame. I know there is a place for it. Utter shamelessness is not what we are after. I have learned much through the shame I've experienced, and there are times when I should experience more of it, but I still hate it. I hate how pervasive it is, how it stalks in disguise beneath so many modern problems. Look under anger, fear, even guilt, and you will find a root of shame. I hate to see the suffering. People are dying from it, some quickly, others slowly. It is the heart disease of this and every era. Shame is Tolkien's ringwraiths. The Nazgul came again, like vultures that expect their fill of doomed men's flesh. I asked a group of 100 students if they experienced shame. They were an excellent class, ages 22 to 68, male and female, thoughtful, wise, and adept at helping others through complicated problems. Not too many people want to acknowledge shame in their lives, so I didn't expect many to raise their hands. Maybe a few auction-like finger twitches or head nods. But I did begin the discussion with an illustration of shame in my own life, which probably made the class feel a little more comfortable. We are going to talk about shame this evening. Have any of you experienced shame? I hoped at least one person would come to my rescue and leave me feeling less exposed. Then, as if to guarantee that no one would raise his or her hand, I added, debilitating shame? Immediately, the entire class raised their hands in unison. I was hoping for one or two hands. To see so many broke my heart. Who would have thought? It was as if they simply needed a place where it was okay to acknowledge their shame. I hope this book is a place where you can identify shame, acknowledge it in your life, bring hope to it, and then be humbled, not humiliated, as you receive comforting words and cleansing acts from God. I hope this book is a safe place. Though the book will start by jumping into a number of descriptions of shame, the answers to shame will unfold gradually, because the Bible has so much to say about it. Its words can't be shared or assimilated quickly. It is a story that builds until you can actually notice beauty without the sense of foreboding that it will soon be swallowed up by pain and disgrace. What is shame? Shame is the deep sense that you are unacceptable because of something you did, something done to you, or something associated with you. You feel exposed and humiliated. Or, to strengthen the language, you are disgraced because you acted less than human. You were treated as if you were less than human, or you were associated with something less than human, and there are witnesses. These definitions can get us started. There isn't one mandatory definition or description for shame, but any definition will include certain elements. For example, you can expect images of being an outsider, naked and unclean. And don't forget shame's public nature. Guilt can be hidden. Shame feels like it is always exposed. Once you identify shame, you can find it everywhere. A middle-aged man seemed fine to others, though he himself felt like a little boy, stuck in the past, inadequate, small, and worthless. A decent job couldn't erase the words and actions of his parents. Some of the words were all too common. You will never amount to anything. Those words were bad enough. Now add his parents' indifference to his recounting of his school day, coupled with their enthusiasm whenever his sisters appeared. No wonder he had a lingering sense that something was very wrong with him. That sense is called shame. Or you can find shame in a recently married woman who feels dirty after a sexual encounter with her husband. She remembers some inappropriate sexual touching by her brothers and wonders what else happened that she doesn't remember. Sometimes the descriptions of shame in this book will be jolting. For example, "you are an outcast" is blunt, matter of fact, and a bit impolite. A nicer way to say this would be, "you feel as if you are an outcast. You feel as if you are worthless, though you really aren't." Shame doesn't seem as oppressive when you insert enough "feel as ifs." If you only feel shameful, maybe it can be covered over by some affirming self-talk, and you'll be good to go. "Don't pay attention to what you feel, because it isn't true. You really are acceptable and worthy. Clean as a whistle. Really. Just ignore the fact that you feel naked, contaminated, and rejected. Think positive." Well, that is not true. Shame is not a mirage. It is very real. A sexually violated woman feels contaminated by what has been done to her, and she really is contaminated. A person who has lived with rejection can't neutralize it with happy thoughts. Shame is like dirt. No matter how it happened, you are a mess, and something has to be done about it. When you are dirty, there is no "feel as if" about it. Wishful thinking is ineffective. Psychiatric medications, drugs or alcohol, a change in perspective, and self-affirmation are equally ineffective. Shame demands something much more potent than these superficial treatments. The first steps out of shame will be the hardest. These are the anti-denial steps, in which we will put shame into words. You can't do battle with something nameless, and too often shame eludes accurate identification. So we will search for words that bring shame out into the open, where it can be seen and fought against. The words you hear in this book, though you might not want to hear them, will be familiar to you. Many of them have been your long-time companions. At times they will make you want to turn away. But don't give up. Stay with it. Identification is only the first step. It isn't the whole story. After that, you will hear God's words to the shamed, and you will discover shame's opposite. You are acceptable. You will receive honor, value, worth, even glory, and it will be public. At first, you might be suspicious. As if God's words are too good to be true. Are they just more happy thoughts? More positive self-affirmation? Don't turn away. As those words pile up, as you can no longer deny God's accepting love, you will want to turn toward Him and hear more. Listen for the love. Hate the shame and have no tolerance for resignation. That's the plan. Shame uncovered. We are familiar with guilt. Shame is more elusive. But once you name it, you can see it everywhere. That is one of the goals for the next few chapters, to see it everywhere. You might be tempted to say, "enough already," after the first few minutes, because it can be painful to rehearse shameful experiences. But you can't hear good news about shame unless you first identify it. As you do, you will discover that shame afflicts us all. What is shame? You are shunned. Faces are turned away from you. They ignore you, as if you didn't exist. You are naked. Faces are turned toward you. They stare at you, as if you were hideous. You are worthless, and it's no secret. You are of little or no value to those whose opinions matter to you. Chapter 2. Shame exposed. I suck. That's what shame says on a good day. Loser. That you would think it was a surname. John Loser. Jane Loser. You will find shame in the girl who obsesses about suicide. While her classmates take part in their normal schoolgirl chatter, She reflects on how her life is one big mistake. She is certain that she doesn't deserve to live, and she is 10 years old. Or consider Carlos Acosta, the world-famous Cuban dancer, who as a young boy was sent to a boarding school far from home. While there, he started talking to the cockroaches. Why? They and I had much in common. Carlos, thank you. These are hard words, but they are words that identify the dehumanizing nature of shame. It's a start. Take a closer look at a heroin addict. Yes, he has trashed the lives of others, but his specialty is trashing his own. Why do such a thing? Because he is certain he deserves the very worst. Addiction, with all its humiliating behaviors and degrading consequences, perfectly depicts an addict's ever-present shame. Watch Ewan McGregor's character in the movie Trainspotting as he goes swimming in the worst toilet in Scotland, looking for his beloved heroin suppository. He is more than a mere junkie. He is a performance artist who is acting out his autobiography. Shame is everywhere. Even children can identify it. "That's yucky," is their version. "Ick" was among my granddaughter's first words. Initially, it is about mud, peas, sticky hands, and squished spiders. Something is dirty. Don't touch. If you do, be sure to wash your hands. In a few years, "yucky" will describe boys for girls and girls for boys. Sadly, for many women, and more men than you would think, soon after that, it describes themselves. Expect to find "ick" and "yucky" not just at the extremes of abuse or addiction, but in everyday life. Expect to find it in your life. Just talk to someone who has been on the short end of a divorce, the spouse who wanted to stay in the marriage. Guaranteed, that person feels yucky. Long before the marriage was over, the cutting words or actual betrayal took its toll. Someone promised to love and didn't. Despite all evidence to the contrary, if you are the forsaken person, you are sure there is something very wrong with you. You are worthless. It doesn't matter that divorce is commonplace, and you are, probably, no longer shamed by neighbors or fellow church members. You can do a fine job heaping shame on yourself. All it takes is a tradition of demeaning, critical words from the right person. All it takes is nothing from the right person. No interest in you, no words spoken to you, no love. If you are treated as if you do not exist, you will feel shame. Get fired from a job. Fail. That will do it, if others know about it. A young man who recently lost his job noticed his shame when he wanted to talk to his friends about the loss to get their support and counsel. He also noticed it when he wanted to avoid those same friends because who wants to announce that he doesn't measure up? He decided to take the middle course and lie. The company was downsizing. Do you find that your resume is never quite good enough? Do you ever boast, just a bit, in conversation with colleagues or friends? Boasting is a kind of cover-up to make yourself look more honorable, or at least acceptable. Have you ever name-dropped with the hopes of getting a little glory by association? What are we so ashamed about? Why do we always have to cover up an unseemly part of ourselves? It doesn't take long before you see shame everywhere. The hum of low-grade self-loathing and shame. On the surface, life might look fine. Tennis pro Andre Agassi was successful by almost any standard, yet his secret meth habit did double duty. It gave him a high, and at the same time, I get an undeniable satisfaction from harming myself and shortening my career. After decades of merely dabbling in masochism, I'm making it my mission. I hate tennis more than ever, but I hate myself more. Yes, shame has a death wish. Maybe you know it as low self-esteem, in which case you really see it everywhere. The words worthless and failure seem to be inscribed on our birth certificates, and they travel with us through life. Just try dislodging low self-esteem with good grades, above average income, or the red sports car. It won't budge. Shame is complicated indeed. Low self-esteem can say, "I want to be greater than I am, and I feel bad because I am not more successful. Our pride runs deep, and it is one of low self-esteem's accomplices. The other is our shame. Shame says, you are not acceptable, you are a mistake. At first you might hear it from others, such as parents or classmates. Later you make it your own. I am not acceptable. I am a mistake. You confess things that aren't your fault. Being the target of someone's anger or contempt. Being hurt or rejected by other people. Being alive. Being born. Being. Ironically, despite its reputation for separating the elite from the untouchable, shame has no prejudices or preferences. It insinuates its way into the essence of rich and poor, majority and minority, failures and successes. It targets anyone and everyone. Ugh, what a way to begin. Shame is crude, intrusive, demanding, and relentless. Don't expect subtlety or refined manners. But we are not going to turn away. That would mean hopelessness and defeat. Instead, up ahead we will search for words that speak for you. Then we will search for words that speak to you. We are going to set our sights on shame. Shame attaches itself to our humanness and is more common than you think. It often hides in guilt's shadow. So we might speak about guilt when shame is the real culprit. We might speak about forgiveness and no condemnation. Yet shame is unmoved by such things. When a judge says, not guilty, and you still feel like scum, the verdict doesn't bring much help or hope. You might even find it a little disappointing. At least a guilty verdict would give you a chance to make amends or atone for something. Shame and guilt. Shame and guilt are close companions, but not identical. Shame is the more common and broader of the two. In Scripture, you will find shame, nakedness, dishonor, disgrace, defilement, about 10 times more often than you find guilt. Guilt lives in the courtroom, where you stand alone before the judge. It says, you are responsible for wrongdoing and legally answerable. You are wrong. You have sinned. The guilty person expects punishment and needs forgiveness. Shame lives in the community, though the community can feel like a courtroom. It says, you don't belong. You are unacceptable, unclean, and disgraced because you are wrong. You have sinned. Guilt. Or, wrong has been done to you. Or, you are associated with those who are disgraced or outcast. The shamed person feels worthless, expects rejection, and needs cleansing, fellowship, love, and acceptance. Guilt and shame intersect when a particular sin is regarded, by yourself or others, to be worse than most sins. For example, get caught with child pornography, and you will experience both guilt and shame. Same-sex attraction finds itself here too. But what if your anger briefly flares at a reckless driver? You might feel a little guilt, but most likely no shame, because everyone else has done similar things. Don't forget that your senses for guilt and shame are fallible. They can be silent when they should say something, and they can also sound false alarms. But false alarm or not, when we hear them, we must do something. They don't turn off automatically. These days, shame is emerging from the shadows and beginning to have its own identity. For example, if you talk about guilt to people under 30, you often get blank stares. But if you talk about worthless, failure, or shame, they feel as if you have deciphered the core of their being. For them, shame is arguably the human problem. If the next generation is talking about it, that's a good sign, in the sense that shame may soon receive the attention it deserves. Meanwhile, you won't hear about it on the national news, nor even in many Sunday sermons. It's hard to know how to speak about the unspeakable. You don't mention shameful things in polite conversation. With this in mind, the first order of business is to face shame and describe it. Once out, it will put up a fight. But there is a path that actually leads away from shame and ends in acceptance and honor. Otherwise, there would be no point in doing anything beyond trying to live with it. Here are some basics about shame. Shame is life-dominating and stubborn. Once entrenched in your heart and mind, it is a squatter that refuses to leave. You might notice hints of it when you are embarrassed. You pick your nose in public and get caught. You break out in acne and someone points it out. At those moments, you don't fit in, and everyone knows it. There is a momentary rupture of relationships. You turn red. You wish you could die right on the spot. But there is an important difference between embarrassment and shame. Whatever caused your embarrassment has been experienced by everyone else too at one point or another. Your sense of social isolation was fleeting. Within the hour, or decade, you laugh about it. With shame, you never laugh at it. It feels like unending embarrassment. But it is more than that. Embarrassment doesn't afflict the core of a person's soul, but shame becomes your identity. It touches everything about you. Embarrassment points towards shame, but it wears away over time. For shame to wear away, it feels as though the shameful person would have to wear away, and some people have tried such things. Imagine a 10-year-old boy, smaller and less athletic than his peers, waiting to be picked for a soccer game. Two of the more honored, that is, cool boys, are captains, and they select teams from a group of eager participants. The two go back and forth, choosing the best players first. As players are chosen, they walk to their teams and the selection pool gets smaller and smaller. With each pick, the remaining boys become increasingly self-conscious, then embarrassed. Shame, however, is reserved for the last boy standing, who isn't picked at all. Slowly, head down, he walks to the side that is stuck with him. The opposing team laughs, while his team groans as if they have become contaminated. Apparently, shame is contagious. The young boy spreads it to his new teammates, but he shouldn't expect anyone to say, "Okay, we're all in this together." The shamed boy will be the scapegoat for the team's loss, and somehow, he will be blamed for any teammate's misfortune for the next week. This experience might pass. The rejected boy might become a respected and powerful CEO, where he gets to do the picking and the rejecting. The curse of that old shameful experience has been reversed. But it's not always that easy. More often than not, scratch the surface of the CEO, and the rejected 10-year-old boy is still there, still hearing the derision of his classmates. Do the following sound familiar? You feel so wrong, but you don't know why. Blame always seems to end up at your doorstep. You still feel the shameful moment as vividly as the day it happened. Sometimes it even feels worse. For young girls, sport is not the prime venue for shame. Boys are. How many times does a young girl want to run away and hide because she wasn't asked to dance, didn't go to the prom, or was ignored by a boy she liked? Stay with me. We are just getting started. There is good news to come. But the only way to get to the good news is to bring our shame out into the open. Sometimes shame grabs hold of your heart and life because of something that happened to you. It doesn't matter that so many others have experienced these things. With shame, misery doesn't care if it has company. Lepers might live in the same colony, but they share no vibrant community. Any sexual violation brings shame to the victim. In creation, there are God-given boundaries that establish where things belong. We all have a sense of this, even with everyday objects. For example, mud is fine by a pond, but not on your hands or in a home. When sex happens outside its intended boundaries, it brings shame on the victim. It should bring shame on the perpetrator. Unfaithfulness in marriage brings shame on the betrayed spouse. It should bring shame on the unfaithful spouse. Verbally battered men and women are filled with shame. They have been told that they are wretched, and, once they get worn down, they believe it. Then they feel compelled to endure the abuse in silence, because it is shameful to reveal that someone who is supposed to love them now berates them. Women who have been treated like objects experience humiliation and shame. Sadly, Nearly every woman has been treated this way at some time. Did you grow up with an angry, unpredictable parent who exploded, apologized, and exploded again? When this person was angry, he or she spoke piercing and demeaning words, and those words outweighed any apology. When you live around irrational anger, you will eventually blame yourself. Any rejection, neglect, or demeaning words by someone who is supposed to love you, such as a parent or a spouse, brings shame. Adopted children can feel different from children living with biological parents. Even when their adoptive parents love them well, they can hear the message inside their heads. You were rejected. Somebody didn't want you. You are not like everyone else. If you are noticeably different, physically, intellectually, or financially, you know shame. And who doesn't feel noticeably different in at least one of these categories? Have you ever said, "I'm ugly" or "I'm stupid"? People who went through school with misunderstood learning disabilities or learning abilities always experience shame, even as successful adults. Even in our enlightened era, psychiatric hospitalization brings shame. If you carry extra body weight in a culture obsessed with thinness, you carry shame. Fall below the community standards of beauty, and you carry shame. Filing bankruptcy, losing a job, and being forced to rely on the generosity of others all bring shame. Sometimes shame comes because of what happened to you, but you can't point to a particular event. Instead, it comes from the gradual accumulation of demeaning words and actions. Daily criticism from those you respect will add up to shame. There might be offhand comments, perhaps even joking remarks, about how you never measure up. The poet Elizabeth Bishop once described her childhood as naturally born guilty. She used the word guilt as a tamer substitute for shame. Racial minorities can be the numerical majority in some places, but wherever they live, they sense their different status every day. Racism is never far away. The last degrading comment or racial slur was probably heard within the last 24 hours. Racism tries to impose shame onto an entire group of people, and it is usually successful. Do you believe that one of your siblings was favored? Is there good evidence for that? If so, your parents, who know you best, chose someone else over you. It's like getting picked last every day. Was a parent or caretaker a heavy drinker or drug user? You will be called horrible things. You will feel different from other people, and you will feel responsible. Were parents absent, preoccupied with their own problems, untrustworthy about their commitments, or inconvenienced by your presence? You felt shame. Sometimes, shame attaches to you because of what you did or do. Addicts live with shame. Whether the problem is drugs, alcohol, food, or sex, no one tells you that when you fall in love with any of these, you also say, "I do," to shame. Then, when shame strikes, it is so nasty you have to numb yourself. And what better anesthetic than your addiction? It is the perfect vicious circle. Homosexuality follows the same path. Those who have same-sex imaginations or act on their impulses often feel shame. If you do anything seen as scandalous by you or your community, expect to experience shame. Victims of sexual violation often report perverted sexual imaginations, such as fantasies of bondage or prostitution. These are deeply shameful and seem sinful. If you have these fantasies, you will certainly feel contaminated. However, these fantasies usually would not have existed without victimization. They are a tragic consequence of being linked to someone else's sin and violence. What do you want to hide? That is a shortcut to identifying shame in your life. Anything connected with nudity and genital contact outside God-given boundaries will bring shame. Yes, the connection between shame and sex has already been mentioned, but it can't be overemphasized. If you have an overactive or scrupulous conscience, every wrongdoing or perceived wrongdoing will add to your heap of shame. Every sordid thought, however fleeting, causes you to retreat ever further from other people. Sometimes shame is the result of your associations. Did something shameful happen in your family? Has there been a suicide, poverty, a public failure, public immorality, someone imprisoned? Remember that one person's shame rubs off on those near him or her. If you are close to someone or something shameful, you can feel shame too. Are you associated with a people group that committed atrocities? That will bring shame too. Perhaps you feel we've done much more than dip our toes in the water. Does drowning feel more like it? That's the problem with shame. There is no gradual way to deal with it. Could there be a gradual way to deal with something so lethal? If you approach it tentatively, you can expect defeat. Shame will never surrender its power over you if you are tentative about it. You need to identify it and attack it with hope. Here is what we know and where we are going. First, shame is blended into our present human condition. That doesn't mean that happiness and joy only come at the cost of massive denial. No, there can be real contentment and peace. We don't feel all of our emotions at once. But if you look deeply within yourself, you will find shame. It is part of being human. It is why hiding and covering are universal instincts. Second, we can be bold in the face of shame, because shame can be removed, though not by something we do. There is absolutely nothing you can do to detach it, which you already know. You might try bolstering your resume, confronting your low self-esteem with positive affirmations, or even reciting to yourself the new identity given you by God. But all these strategies are like putting cheap paint over rust. They might work for a season, but the rust will win in the end. There is only one specific remedy that can bring change and transform. The purpose of this journey is to discover that remedy and let it wash you all over. Third, shame is tackled best in the context of a relationship. Granted, going public with your shame is something you have tried to avoid, but being open about it, at least with someone who is a wise encourager, is part of the way out of shame. Wonderful deeds deserve to be praised publicly, but if your shame is due to something evil that someone else did to you, those deeds deserve to be publicly unpraised, as a friend said to me, and you can't do that by yourself. Do not allow shame to intimidate you into silence. For discussion and reflection. 1. How are you responding to what you've heard so far? Are you hopeful? Feeling sick to your stomach? A little of both? 2. How would you define shame? How would you distinguish it from embarrassment? 3. How would you distinguish shame and guilt? They overlap, so their treatments overlap. But what does shame need that makes it unique? 4. Some violations feel highly personal, but they don't permanently damage the victim. Theft is one example. A t-shirt stolen at the local gym is maddening. A cell phone stolen from your car is a loss, and you swear to lock your car ever after. But a locket and heirloom jewelry stolen from your bedroom is personal. You feel dirty, defiled. Your privacy has been invaded. These injustices, however, don't provoke shame. What makes some violations shameful? 5. Women can usually identify shame in their lives without much effort. Men tend to feel it, but not identify it. If you are a man, see if you can locate that shamed little boy. 6. Can you see the benefit of putting the experiences that shamed you into words and actually speaking those words to someone? One benefit is that it shatters the myth that shame must remain hidden at all costs. What are other benefits? 7. What would you add to the lists of shameful experiences in this chapter? What is shame? You are different. Rejected. Exposed. Contaminated. Chapter 3. Shame through the years. It might help to know that the struggle with shame has been quietly waged throughout history. For example, you probably remember Nathaniel Hawthorne's novel, The Scarlet Letter, in which Hawthorne identified the intersection between guilt and shame. In the book, Hester Prynne forever wore the scarlet A as punishment for her adultery. Was she guilty? Yes. And forgiveness is the very center of Jesus' message to her. She had sinned, and there is always forgiveness available for sinners. Always. Yet the story is really about her shame, the public and lasting scorn she received from the community. When you receive such reproach from the community, you can easily believe that God himself joins those many voices, though he certainly does not. Hester's Scarlet A is a literary reminder that, once shame attaches itself, it's hard to get rid of it. At least that's the way it feels. The only time Hester removed her letter, her daughter refused to go near her. She didn't recognize her mother without the mark of shame. Meanwhile, Reverend Dimmesdale, the adulterous partner whose identity Hester did not reveal, wore his own scarlet letter, which he privately etched onto his own bare chest. Sadly, the story is timeless. Hester Prynne is much more than a marginalized and shamed adulteress. Both she and Reverend Dimmesdale speak for shame specialists who wear a scarlet A perpetually, either in public or in private. Most of us notice at least a trace of shame in our lives, but there are some who have reminders every single day. If you are wearing a scarlet A, or any other scarlet letter, our aim is to get rid of it so that no one, including yourself, will be able to find any evidence that it ever existed. You have heard of stocks and pillory, which figure in the scarlet letter. Stocks were wooden boards that locked together around your feet. If you broke the law, in you would go. You could find them at marketplaces, prominent crossroads, or large gathering spaces to intensify the public humiliation. If you swore, you could be locked up for an hour. Drunkenness might get you 4, but at least your hands were free to defend yourself from the objects that might be thrown at you. You weren't so fortunate with a pillory. If you were put in one of them, you would stand with your arms and head locked between 2 wooden boards, defenseless against yesterday's rotting food. Thieves often ended up there. Do you think that those who were once in stocks or the pillory were more sympathetic to the next person in line? Or do you think they were among the first to throw garbage and hurl insults? If you struggle with shame, you might find a little of both responses in yourself. You might have compassion for some, while you stand in judgment over others. The worst part of the stocks and pillory was the public spectacle of it all. The best part was that you were eventually released to re-enter everyday life. If people threw garbage at you then, they would end up in the stocks. The system sounds inhumane, but at least the person's release acted as a public announcement that he or she was now socially acceptable. I don't doubt that if people could be done with their shame today by spending a few hours in the stocks, we would see an endless line of volunteers. Shame remains an essential feature of punishments around the world. If humans have an aversion to feeling shame, why not exploit this as a way to control unwanted behavior? Parents have often used demeaning tactics to control their children. You should be ashamed of yourself. Not long ago, even teachers prided themselves on mastering these strategies, as many students in parochial schools before the 1980s can tell you. We are only a generation or two removed from dunce caps and public embarrassment in the classroom. But present strategies of people in power go far beyond the stocks and pillory. In lawless regimes around the world, soldiers go on sprees of rape and other forms of humiliation. Their despicable acts are part of the leadership's tactics because shame gives power. That is, the ones who humiliate have power over the humiliated. It becomes a form of social control because shamed people rarely take stands against injustice. Such a stand would mean they would have to go public, which would only double the shame. Instead, once we are shamed, most of us try to make sense of it by believing we are getting what we deserve. so why would we protest? You can find this in the souls of most sexually victimized women. They are of two minds. On the one hand, they know they were victims of ungodly perpetrators. But right next to that conviction is an equally strong sense that they, somehow, deserved what they received. Even worse, they might think that God himself decreed the injustice as a form of punishment. Be on guard. Assume that shame always accumulates lies. Since the desires for power and control are in every heart, you don't have to look overseas for lawless brutality. It happens every day, between parents and children, boyfriends and girlfriends, husbands and wives. Where there is injustice, shame will be part of its fallout. For discussion and reflection. 1. Can you think of other historical or fictional figures that capture the experience of shame? Did they do something shameful for that era? Or were they treated shamefully? Hester experienced both. 2. Are you or people you love walking around with a scarlet A? What is that like? 3. Can you identify any modern versions of the stocks and pillory? 4. Would you volunteer for the stocks or pillory? Why or why not? 5. It is never too soon to look for the lies that attach themselves to shame. What lies can you identify? What is shame? You are worthless. Nothing. Zero. Chapter 4. Shame and Disgust. Let's do a little more to bring shame out in the open. Shame connects three human experiences. You feel like an outcast. You don't belong. You feel naked. While everyone else is walking around with their clothes on, you feel exposed and vulnerable. You are seen, and what others see is not pretty. You feel unclean. Something is wrong with you. You are dirty. Even worse, you are contaminated. There is a difference between being a bit muddy and harboring a deadly contagious virus. When you put words to it, you can find it everywhere. The ancient cultures of Asia have identified shame as the deepest problem of humanity. They have elaborate systems to manage it. For them, shame comes up daily. If you don't get into the right school, for example, you have shamed your entire family. If you don't measure up to any of the innumerable expectations of your family or culture, you lose face. Your job is to maintain the social status of your group. Otherwise, you dishonor yourself and others. Ugh. You don't just bring shame on yourself. You bring it on others too. But that shouldn't surprise us, because we already know that shame can contaminate those who are close by. Western countries are less sophisticated when it comes to shame. The relative youth of our culture leaves us with a limited vocabulary for it, and our social conventions expect us to manage shame on our own, but you can still find it everywhere. Here are a few places to look. Depression. What depressed person doesn't think of himself or herself as a miserable, unredeemable failure? Anger, as in, stay away, or you will see me, and what you see won't be pretty. Look for the paradoxical combination of self-loathing and arrogant judgment. Men are specialists at this. Anorexia. The deep logic of anorexia is that you are unworthy and deserve nothing, so you give yourself nothing. If you give yourself nothing, perhaps you will disappear, or at least less of you will be seen. Fear and withdrawal. You might as well avoid other people, since you feel like you don't belong with them. You don't want to be seen. Exhibitionism. The person who is the life of the party acts shameless in the hope that such a thing is possible. Addiction. This will both cause shame and cure it, at least temporarily. Cutting. This seems like the perfect treatment. It punishes you for being bad, and the blood makes you feel punished, and therefore cleansed. Of course, cutting silence is shame for only an hour or so, but at least that's something. Fears of being exposed. Among the socially or financially successful can lurk a persistent sense that they are only one misstep from being found out and humiliated. Suicide. Sadly, some people who expect to be exposed and humiliated feel as if they have no alternative but suicide. Many others who live with shame wish they could take their lives, but they are too afraid of what death might bring. Doubts that God could ever love you. Who could love something so gross? Saying, "I can't forgive myself," you actually might be saying, "I believe God has forgiven me, but something is still wrong. I still feel dirty." Saying, "I'm just a failure." Who hasn't thought that? Of course, families remain the hotbed for shame. Non-Asian families don't typically have the same expectations for success that many Asian families can impose in their quest for honor. But all families can reject, criticize, abuse, and shun. The message is clear. You have fallen short. You don't measure up. Other people are acceptable. You are not. They succeed. You fail. They are good. You are bad. They are important. You are disposable. It is all about value and worth. The shamed person feels worthless in the eyes of others and worthless before God. Every culture has its worthless and esteemed, honored and rejected. Tribes, even street gangs, have their rivals who are viewed with contempt. The Hutu have the Tutsi, the Sinhalese, the Tamil, and the Islamic Sudanese, the Christian, and vice versa. The schoolyard is the world in miniature. During the very first recess, the caste system begins falling into place. The popular kids have the prestige, while the unpopular ones are devalued, ignored, or ridiculed. Sometimes these outcasts form their own tribe, but it too will soon have its own dictator and less worthy underlings. Life at the top looks enviable from a distance. Yet since shame is more pervasive than it first appears, you will discover that even some of the popular children who do the choosing and belittling go home to parents who belittle them. Their schoolyard bravado is a cover-up. Their derisive words are attempts to enhance reputations they already fear are beyond redemption. Go visit the upper reaches of the social ladder, the successes. Look behind the resume, and you often find an ashamed little kid who is still trying to prove his or her worth. When corporate executives sneak into therapists' offices, they tell stories of insecurity. They feel like frauds. They want advice on how to keep disgrace at bay. When famous actors speak openly, they reveal that they find peace only when they play roles other than themselves. What about people who are self-confident and boastful? There is more trouble there than you might think as well. Authentic human beings know they are imperfect and needy creatures, and they are not compelled to boast. Honorable people don't need to boast. Boasting and arrogance are for those who have deceived themselves into thinking that shame can be banished with a hyped press release. All this leaves us wondering, if the popular and prestigious people feel as marginalized and fearful of exposure as the rest of us. If so, we need something more profound than a climb up the social ladder or a bigger paycheck to cast off shame. A passing comment about your cool car or nice body is not enough to rehabilitate scum, if that's what you believe you are. Shame isn't impressed by our possessions or accomplishments. You don't fit in. The world around you has some kind of standard for what is acceptable, and you don't measure up. You are on the sidelines and everyone else is in the game. You are off in the shadows while your friends are on the dance floor. Here are some key words to go along with shame. Inferior, alienated, embarrassed, minority, ridiculed, weak, powerless, failure, different, insulted, rejected, inadequate, humiliated, ignored,
loser.
These words point in the right direction, but some of them, such as embarrassed, insulted, different, and ignored, can fade with time. Real shame requires more intensity. That's why the language of this next list may make you want to stop listening. But it's much closer to shame. Words such as unclean, dishonored, filthy, shunned, disgusting, defiled, outcast, unlovable, discarded, repulsive, disgraced, worthless, loathed, scorned, vile, disgusting. I am disgusting. It took her a few weeks to put words to how she saw herself. She had to dig through a few layers. The top layer of her life seemed very ordinary. She was married, with kids, and had enough money to pay the bills. Depression always seemed to be nipping at her heels. But maybe she was just a little tired. Peel back that layer, and you heard anger. It seemed to be directed at everyone. But there was more. The next layer revealed her habitual cutting. She had been so discreet her husband didn't even know about it, and in some ways, she herself didn't even know. Then there was the next layer. I am disgusting. In other words, the idea that you are on the B team, or never invited to the big dance, is far too tame. Shame has much more affinity with the leper who cries out, unclean, and contaminates others with a mere touch. Some take showers with the hope that they can be clean. A lawyer who witnesses executions washes his clothes. Others try to purge themselves of filth by shedding their own blood as a way to be more acceptable. Blood may seem like a poor substitute for soap and water, but blood sacrifice has a long history. There is something about uncleanness that asks for blood. Now go one step further. Sometimes with shame, there are no words. Shame takes us to the extremes where words fall short. So we express shame by doing disgusting things. Intentional vomiting and degrading promiscuity can be part of it. Less degrading, though just as effective, is intentional failure in work or relationships. Yes, shame can deliberately undermine any possible success. If you catch a whiff of something good, you treat it as a threat. You run from it, drink at it, drug at it, sabotage it. Why else would a bright young man with a promising future embezzle company funds when he knew that the company accounting system would eventually expose him? People who live with shame believe they don't deserve anything good. Sure, others get hurt by shame's self-destructive ways, but it's not as if you wanted to hurt them. You are doing your loved ones a favor, you think, if you distance yourself from them. You will ruin lives eventually, so you might as well get it over with. He actually had words for himself. His self-ascribed moniker was the Ruiner. He left behind a woman who had an abortion, a friend who died from a drug overdose while he was the drug supplier, 3 good jobs because of his addiction to alcohol, and a destitute ex-wife and 2 children. He heard there was good news about forgiveness of sins and acceptance for the defiled, and he wanted to believe it. But he held on to the lies that said, "You have slid so far into the pit you could never crawl out." The Ruiner was a description that had become a prophecy, and he was committed to being a true prophet. In his case, shame reflected his shameful behavior. But his biography was complicated. Find shameful behavior, and you often find people who were also shamed by others. The Ruiner had been ruined by his parents' divorce, his father's rejection, and a woman who decided to abort their child without even consulting him. Sometimes we do shame. Sometimes we are shamed. And many times we are a combination of both. One way the world has hurled shame on other people is by spitting on them. Watch a handful of movies and you will come across at least one scene in which someone is being spit on. Most recipients believe they deserved it. They think they did something disgusting, so they deserve something disgusting. The tradition goes all the way back to biblical times. If her father had but spit in her face, should she not be shamed 7 days? Numbers 12, verse 14. If he persists, saying, "I do not wish to take her," then his brother's wife shall go up to him in the presence of the elders, and pull his sandal off his foot, and spit in his face, and she shall answer, and say, "So shall it be done to the man who does not build up his brother's house." Deuteronomy 25, verses 8 to 9. It gets worse. In World War II, the concentration camps of Auschwitz, Dachau, and Buchenwald were shame factories where Nazis toiled to dehumanize Jews. Among their methods was one constant. Every Jew was called excrement or piece of crap. The language of shame is extreme. Hear it enough, and you believe it. You are told you are disgusting and unclean, and eventually you believe you are. For many men and women who experience shame, Nazi-style name-calling would be redundant. They already have been calling themselves those names for years. There it is again. It is hard to talk about shame gradually and delicately, because shame sucks you into darkness. If you try to sanitize it, you are just trying to avoid or deny its ugliness, its deadliness. No one can blame you for wanting to minimize the experience. After all, who wants to stare into something that seems to cannibalize our humanity? But that is hopelessness talking. Don't forget, there is a way to be cleansed from shame, and for that reason, shame can and must be confronted. You will encounter raw language in the soul of anyone who is intimate with shame. Scripture itself isn't shy about this. If you are filled with shame, you feel utterly disgusting. And what is more disgusting than excrement? Or vomit, maybe. Which may be why the purging of bulimia serves double duty. It is both a dieting aid and a way to express self-contempt. But it's hard to name anything else so gross. No wonder Scripture makes the connection between dung and shame. But when they went to bury her...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.